Well, good morning and welcome to Flint First this morning. We're so happy to see everybody here today. If you don't know who I am, my name is Chad, and my wife Amy and I are the co-lead pastors here at Flint First, and we're excited to have you all here with us this morning. This is an exciting and monumentous milestone for the church, and we're just happy that so many people were able to come back and to visit with us and to just share in this moment with us. I'd like to recognize a couple people that I believe are here that I haven't actually seen, but I believe Liz Salo, is Liz here? I haven't seen her yet, so I heard that Liz was going to be here, and then also Judy Livingston are recognizing. These are, Liz is the wife of a former pastor, and Judy is the daughter of one of our former pastors, so we just wanted to thank them again if they're able to make it. But the Heritage Committee has worked really hard in being able to put all this together. They have countless hours and their team, and we just want to again thank them for all the work that they've done, and just to remember that God has been so faithful over the last 110 years in this church, in the life of the people that have grown up here and that have invested so much time here. So we're going to share, we're going to embrace how God has been working in the past and how he's working currently today, and then we're going to look ahead to the future to see how God is going to continue to work and to bless this church for the years and years to come. So again, thank you for joining us for the celebration.
Yeah, the Old Testament is filled with so many examples of the children of Israel forgetting the many miracles and just the spiritual experiences given to them by the Lord. Remember. It could be the most important command almost we're given, right? This literally was a command given by God to the Israelites. Remember. Remember when they crossed the Jordan River and they walked across on dry ground. God told the Israelites to stack 12 stones to represent the 12 tribes of Israel so they could remember what had happened. This strong statement to remember, it gives us time to pause and to reflect on how faithful God has been and how he has brought us to this point in our lives. By recognizing our past experiences, we're building our own monument. If we do not reflect upon these times, these moments, we risk forgetting. We're so fickle, aren't we? We forget. And so we don't want to be like the children of Israel. We want to remember. And so as we look to the future, all of our hope and all of our trust is in him. So we have to remember that God has always graciously provided things for us. And so know this, God is still with you. If you are in Christ, God will never leave you. And if you ever doubt that his faithful love, look to the cross.
Amen. Stand with us as we continue to worship our Lord this morning. We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea, my God, he holds the victory. Yeah.
There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise, there's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing.
From that grave, my God, still rolling stones away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord,
there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise, there's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place, and shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free.
We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed.
Services were led by Jay Morningstar, a lay pastor. Little did they know that their small act of faith would begin a ministry in Flint, Michigan that would last more than a century. This two-story building on Lyman Street was called the Apostolic Holiness Church. In 1915, Reverend Charles Cliff was appointed pastor by the Pilgrim Holiness Church. The main floor of the building was used for service, and his family used the second floor for their home. Just 2 short years later, Reverend B.O. Shattuck became the new pastor. Under his leadership, the next church building was built at the corner of Bennett and Olive Avenue, where the church was being dedicated in 1920. In the fall of 1923, Reverend L.W. Sterk was called to be the new pastor. He served faithfully for 14 years until he was elected general superintendent of the denomination. Reverend J.C. Brillhart followed in 1937. 2 years later, Reverend A.S. Joppy took the reins and served our church for 6 years. Reverend A.C. Doering followed in 1945. It was during his ministry that a parsonage was purchased at 506 Crapo Street. The congregation was growing following the end of World War II, and the vacated parsonage next door to the church was needed for space for Sunday school rooms and a place for various activities. 7 years later, in 1952, Reverend W. N. Miller came to the Flint Pilgrim Holiness Church. It was during his leadership the property for 3825 Davison Road was purchased before moving on to become the district superintendent. While still at the church on Bennett and Olive Avenue in 1953, the church came together for the annual rally day. This photo shows exactly why there was a need for a new, bigger building. Reverend D. Wayne Brown was called as pastor in 1954. It was during his direction that this very church we are standing in today was constructed. They broke ground on April 30th, 1961, and held the first service in the building just under 2 years later on Easter Sunday, April 14th, 1963. 3 years later, Reverend Brown was elected General Secretary Treasurer of the Pilgrim Holiness denomination. In 1955, under the direction of Eula Irish, the junior choir of 38 children performed often in church. In 1960, they became the youth choir and were chosen to attend and perform at the National Pilgrim Youth Convention in Wionia Lake, Indiana. This close-knit group continues to meet today. They're now known as the 50s and 60s group, and many of them still attend and are involved in ministries here at Flint First still today. The members of the congregation worked very hard to pay for, build, and to grow the church. Before construction, bonds were sold, and members were able to purchase shares of the church as each family took on the financial responsibility of making the new building a reality. Many of the men in the congregation rolled up their sleeves and went to the actual work of constructing the building. The women went to work as well. The work of growing and raising the next generation is pictured here in the 1962 baby boom. The dedication service for the new church here at 3825 Davison Road was held on October 20th, 1963. 50 years after service had first started in a basement, our church had outgrown three spaces and finally had room for their expanding ministries. In 1966, Reverend Roy B. Webster came to be our pastor. It was during his time of ministry that the new parsonage at 2116 Thistlewood Drive was built. After many conferences, on June 26, 1968, the Pilgrim Holiness Church and the Wesleyan Methodist Church of America were united to form the Wesleyan Church. In 1977, Reverend J. Deneff was called as pastor at First Wesleyan Church. He ministered here for 11 years. In just 14 short years after our church building was completed, in November of 1977, they had completely paid off the mortgage and had a mortgage burning celebration. Here you can see our very own Don Hodson, who was the treasurer at the time, holding the final canceled mortgage check. In 1988, Reverend Ken Boucher became a pastor. He served our church until 1992, when he was elected district superintendent of the East Michigan District. Reverend Dale Freed was called to pastor from 1992 to 1997. Then for 1 year, we were honored to have Reverend Max Amstutz as interim pastor. In 1997, we celebrated another baby boom in our congregation. You may even recognize some familiar faces here, like Andrea Villarreal on the left, Carol Richardson standing in the middle holding baby Hannah Krupp, and Nikki Boca sitting in the front. We called Reverend Jim Salo to be our pastor in 1998. It was under his direction that the church underwent some much-needed remodeling. Reverend Salo went on to minister as chaplain for the Michigan State Police in 2003. Then Reverend Parsons became our pastor. Under his guidance, we became Flint First Wesleyan Church. In 2009, Flint First Wesleyan Church called Reverend Tom Verwise to be our pastor. God led the church in new directions with believers who made the decision to stand together for the cause of Christ. Under Pastor Tom's leadership and with the help of Bruce Jordan, the church started providing video of services to the world via the internet. Pastor Tom did something else a little differently. He hired Reverend Scott Gregonis to intern under him in his final year here before passing the torch to Pastor Scott, who became lead pastor in June of 2015. It was through Pastor Scott's vision and leadership, new lighting and much needed technology updates were made to the main sanctuary and the downstairs worship room as well. Pastor Scott led us through uncharted territory when the COVID-19 pandemic hit in early 2020, where we had to stop meeting in person and moved to a fully online church. We were very thankful that he stayed to lead us back into our first in-person service before leaving in June of that year. In July of 2020, Reverend John Krall became the new lead pastor. He led us through reacclimating together after being away due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Pastor John was a dynamic speaker, and he served until March of 2022. In May of 2022, we were blessed to have Reverend Bill Canaan bridge the gap as intern pastor for nearly a year as we searched for a new lead pastor. In April of 2023, Reverends Chad and Amy Amos became the bivocational co-lead pastors of Flint First. With them, we celebrated our first female lead pastor. They are also unique as Pastor Amy grew up attending CYC and the youth group at the church when Ray and Betty Sturgill were the leaders. Pastors Chad and Amy were involved in various ministries, including being co-directors of the youth ministry for nearly 15 years. The church was blessed that after they both became ordained ministers in August of 2022, they answered the call to continue on here at Flint First.
I said, isn't that awesome to see how many lives that the church has touched and all your faces out there? It just makes my heart so thrilled this morning to see all of you. Okay, I am here to speak on behalf of the longest living member at the present time for Flint First Wesleyan Church, Enid Reed. Start out, I want to give you just a few facts. Enid was born in 1931. And she came to Flint in 1945 when she was 14 years old, when her dad, Pastor Doring, became the pastor. And they lived in the parsonage, I don't know if some of you know this or not, but which was right next to the church on Bennett and Olive. There was a parsonage there for a while until the parsonage moved from there to Craigville. And so then when Enid was 21, somewhere between that time and 21, she met the love of her life, Bob Reed. And Bob and Enid have been such a fixture, so faithful down through the years at this church. You can't talk about Enid without talking about Bob. And so if you guys are listening, Bob and Enid, I hope you are online. We miss you, and we just want to tell you that we love you. And I hope I don't say anything to embarrass you. Okay. I'm going to go to some memories, and it's going to probably play some facts and memories of you guys. But when I was a teenager, and some of you were teenagers, Bob had built a house right after they married, beautiful house. And one thing that they did was serve the Lord in that house. And they had parties. And I remember as a teenager going there to skating parties, ice skating parties. Remember the pond behind the house? It froze over. Bob went out and got the snow off. And we as teenagers would meet at Bob and Nina's, put on our skates, walk down the hill, go ice skating, and come back to a delicious meal that was prepared by Enid. That's one of the first things that I remember. Maybe some of you remember that. Then she had what we called the young married parties at their house. Now, mind you, young married was if you were married 1 year or 20 years. It just never really went beyond that. I don't think any of us grew up. But anyway, and many a party was held at their house. We had Sunday school, and once a month we had parties. So, and again, Enid did her awesome entertaining. We went from there to the New Year's Eve parties. Many of you will remember the New Year's Eve parties that we look forward to every year. And again, she was the entertainer and the one that supplied the, well, we all took in food at that time, if you remember some of those times. And so what I would call Enid a Mrs. Hospitality. She was always willing to put something on, always willing to cook, and just so faithful. And then she also did work in the church office, not to make money. She worked in to help out. That was back in the days when we had a lot of more people than we have now. And she folded bulletins. She sent birthday cards out, get well cards, encouragement cards. And she did that all on her own. The other thing is, I was kind of like to say that if I was to put a, I don't know, say a signature stamp on Enid, it would be she was known for her cooking. I don't think Enid ever cooked a bad meal. And everything she brought to any function was delicious. She was well known for her pies. And if I ask you to raise your hand, many of you would raise your hands today. She made apple pie. Rhubarb pie, which Bob for her to make those. Her chocolate sheet cake. By the way, I want to tell you, I got her recipe for that. If you eat it today, eat some of it, you'll remember Enid. If you have, and she also made a pineapple tart. I could go on and on. But she was an awesome baker. And so, I don't know if you guys, some of you remember this. The news scope that went out. Years past, that there was a letter with different things that were happening on in the church that go into the homes, and in there would be Enid's recipe. So I know many people got recipes for that. And then also the missionary cookbook. I wish you could have, everybody could have had the missionary cookbook. I'm probably half of you have that in your home, and her recipes are in there. So Enid was well rounded. She served, and she baked, and she Mrs. Hospitality, and right along with her was Bob. And so I would like to say to Bob and Enid that thank you, Enid, for serving the Lord. Many of our lives here, or almost all of our lives here, were touched because of something that you did and that we will never forget. We'll keep your recipes forever and pass them on. And we love you, and we wish you could be here.
A I would like to say just a little something. It's a great privilege for me to be back at my home church. It's been quite a while, but this is awesome. 110 years. And I was very privileged to be brought up in this church along with my sisters. There were five girls. My mother and dad started attending this church 93 years ago and brought us five girls up in this church. And, you know, there isn't, God didn't promise any of us that we wouldn't have trials and troubles. But he did promise that he would supply our every need.
I asked the dear Savior what he had purchased for me when at Calvary he died. For all my past and all my problems, he just said that he would supply every need, supply every need, supply healing, cleansing, sweet peace inside. Every need he supplied. If I had to name the greatest blessing he's given, how would I decide? For after he saved me, I just have to say that every need is supplied. Every need supplied. Every need
beautiful. Wasn't that beautiful? Oh. Wow. years he supplied every year, every moment, every hour of every day, all of that time. When we put this thing together, this event together, we reached out to City Hall to find out if the mayor would like to be part of that. In my hand, I have a proclamation from Mayor Neely, and I'm going to be presenting that to Pastor Chad. He's going to read it to you.
Thank you. It says, on behalf of the city of Flint, and with great pleasure that I join Flint First Wesleyan Church on this momentous occasion. And whereas Flint First Wesleyan Church started out in October of 1913 on the corner of Bennett and Olive in Flint, Michigan, under the name of Flint Pilgrim Holiness Church. In 1963, the church purchased land and built the church in its current location and merged with the Wesleyan denomination. And whereas throughout the years, Flint First Wesleyan has been very involved in the community. They offer meals, they're open to the public on Wednesday nights, and they run a monthly food pantry distribution. The church and its volunteers have mowed and helped clean empty lots around the city, and for many years they've tended to Polk Park, in which they mowed, cleaned, and they kept the playground up to par. And whereas Flint First Wesleyan's outreach program has painted and done repairs for homes in the neighborhoods in need, and during the summer they've had several picnics and block parties with food, fellowship, and activities for the children, and they all help out not just those in need and attend the church, but also those in need. Whereas on this day, on October 29th, 2023, the congregation of Flint First Wesleyan Church will celebrate 110 years of their service to the Flint area. By rejoicing in their rich history under the leadership of Pastors Chad and Amy Amos, dynamic leaders and teachers of God's Word, with a special service to commemorate this wonderful milestone. And now, therefore, I, Sheldon A. Neely, Mayor of the great city of Flint, acknowledge Flint First Wesleyan Church for its 110 years of service to the Flint community, and I do hereby proclaim October 29th to be Flint First Wesleyan Church Day. And I, yes. And I invite the citizens of the Flint community to join me as I salute Flint First Wesleyan Church for their untiring work enriching the lives of the residents of Flint and the greater Flint community. Join me in thanking you for your years of service to the community, and may you continue to be a beacon of light to all they encounter. Now I have the distinct privilege of introducing to you a gentleman who has a long history in the church, who's a very influential time here in Flint. Mark Wagner is born and raised in Flint First here before he and his wife, Chris, moved away for work-related purposes. But his wife, Chris, actually worked in the church office. But Mark has served on district boards. He served in the local church board here. He was a Sunday school teacher, member of the choir and the cantata team, very active in Christian education, actually, and church ministry in general. He served as the board president for 13 years at Wilmington Christian, and currently is the head of school for the Trinitas Classical Christian School in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Mark is also a managing partner and co-founder of the Black Barn Solutions, which is a managing consulting firm located in Kennett Square, Pennsylvania. He also was the founder of two technology startup organizations located in Virginia Beach. He completed 34 years of service at DuPont in March of 2020, where he held a variety of positions in technical R&D, manufacturing, marketing, sales, business leadership, and including several short and midterm international assignments. Among his significant positions, Mark include president of DuPont Sustainable Solutions and president of Coastal Training Opportunities, or Technology, and more. He currently resides in Kalamazoo, Michigan with his wife, and he's very active in the community, his church, and serving on different nonprofit boards. So please help me welcome Mark this morning.
So when you hand over some information on how it's going to be used, thank you, Pastor Chad, very much. But it is a blessing and an honor to be back at Flint First, I have to tell you. Doesn't it feel like we've been in church already? We've been in church, and we have more church to come, and so praise God. It is an honor to be back to celebrate 110 years of this entity being together. Just what an honor and a blessing. This is my home church. Anywhere I go, when people talk about where you're from, what's your home church, it is Flint First Wesleyan. It always has been, and Flint First will always be our home church. And we were brought here at a young age, and many of you have played such a vital role in my formation and my family's formation. I'm going to try not to cry, because we've gone through so many things together with this body. And just the formation of who I am and my family, I praise God. This building is my memory, so when you're talking, you get to use your memory. My memory had it that this building was here the same year I was born, which, what year was the building built? 63, I would call it 62. For some reason, in my memory, it was 62, which is the same year I was born, and I know what you're thinking. Yes, Mark Wagner is 61 years old, and that's when they ask you to come and talk about the past. You know, so you know when you're on first to talk about the past, it's time to get things ready. So I entered the building 1962, 63-ish, and Jeff Green and I were born a couple weeks apart, and I've seen a lot of pictures of us, you know, coming into the church as young infants. And so it's great to be back here. The last few years, I've had an opportunity to talk about leadership, which is one of my passions. And when I do that, I get to speak corporately, but I speak a lot to college students that are in their final year of business school, usually, or a final year of an MBA program. And I usually start with a song that the Lord gave me, and he put it on my heart. If we can go to the first slide, it would be great. And it's a song from Mercy Me that is Dear Younger Me. And it is, if I was able to go back and talk to Mark early in my 20s and 30s, what would I say to Mark? And that's a song. And there's three verses here from Mercy Me that I want to share. Dear younger me, I cannot decide. Do I give some speech of how do I get the most out of your life? Or do I go deep and try to change the choices that you'll make because of the choices that made me? Even though I love this crazy life, sometimes I wish it was a smoother ride. Amen to that, right? And it was just so great to hear the McCulley sisters up here and Betty Ann, praise God, that they are represented. It's a blessing to have grown up in the church getting to hear the McCulley sisters often. Thank you, Betty Ann. And your words were powerful. Dear younger me, dear younger me. And so for me, if I was writing to a younger me, and if you're in your 20s, 30s, I'm speaking to you, younger as well, it would be how vital Flint First is going to be in the life of you. I would tell my younger me that it's going to be important to be an active part of the church. You're going to see wisdom. You're going to see how Christian men and women navigate the world's problems. You need to take note of that and really put that to heart. You need to get active in doing ministry, having fellowship with this group of believers. Powerful and a blessing. I was able to gain so much wisdom and knowledge watching many of you go through life and hearing your testimonies of how to deal with various things that come about you. And enjoy, you know, sharing the load with your brothers and sisters in church. And I would say very clearly, do not journey alone. Do not journey alone. So I was thinking, and they timed me so I couldn't go too long. So I had a lot of things I wanted to say, but I boiled it down. I was thinking of all the different things that took place for me here at Flint First since that infant coming in. So I was dedicated here. I also was part of CYC, wore the little banner, collected the little patches. Was part of the youth group. I accepted Christ at 15 years old at Vassar Camp, praise God. I was discipled here. I was baptized here. How many do not know there's a baptismal downstairs that holds water that we used to baptize people in? There is. It's down there. And it is exactly where I was baptized. I explored every inch of this church, mainly on Wednesday nights after, well, choir practice was going on, and was praying I never got caught by Bob Reed or Dave Bundy. Because something bad was going to happen. I got into trouble some, and I got out of trouble a lot. But thank you for that. I prayed and cried at this altar more times than I can say. And this altar is powerful to me. I sang my first solo here, if you can believe that. I was married as a member of the church here. Lived in the area so that I could be part of this church, even though my job was in the Detroit area. I wanted to be part of the church. Active in leading youth ministry, which is a blessing. Had a miraculous adoption of our first daughter. Had a miraculous natural birth of our second daughter. Praise God. Dedicated both of our daughters here. Celebrated the life and loss of my parents here. Made our lifelong friends here. I mean, when you talk about our friends, they came from. Celebrated the life and earthly loss of many of our dear friends here. Some of our dearest friends with Kelly Blewett and recently with Carol Richardson, just lifelong friends that are now waiting for us up in heaven. I've seen miracles happen in our lives. I've seen miracles happen in your lives. I was proud to be a member of the board here, district board member, and as it was said by Chad, Chris worked here. Lord gave me the next slide, which is, nope, one back, Donna. Remember yesterday to impact tomorrow and living a legacy. And one of the things that's important, and John's here, John Blewett, who knows history, and if you're ever in a Trivial Pursuit game and history's coming up, you want John on your team. History is important, but today's culture would teach us not to worry about history. We'll tell you what you need to know going forward. I'm going to tell you we need to learn from history. So history has a quote to give us. Don't make me repeat myself. Okay, and the only way we know not to repeat ourselves is to really understand and spend some time, you know, looking at history. And it's really about not making the same mistakes. C.S. Lewis is one of my favorite authors. He is my favorite author. And he has a quote. As you know by now, I really love quotes. History is a story written by the finger of God. And so that history is the story written by God. God's allowed it to happen. But church history, so this is a quote by me, so I'll put it up there next to my favorite author, C.S. Lewis. One back, Donna. Church history is the continued story of God working through and in his people. Okay, the story of the church is God being active and working through and in his people. And so Flint First for me was filled with heroes of the faith. And I was able to observe testimonies of God at work. I saw how to testify and how important it was to testify. Prayer warriors. There is no more important thing than prayer. No more. We don't spend enough time intentionally praying. And I've seen prayers and prayers and prayers go up and heard the prayers of those. And then really spurring each other on, you know, just doing what the Bible says. Spurring each other on as we head towards our goals in life. Lord gave me this verse to share. And this verse really deals with, Jesus was a famous section of the Bible where he's talking to his disciples, and he says, who do the people, the populace, who do they say that I am? And their response really indicated what the thinking was at the time, that you're John the Baptist, you're Elijah, you're Jeremiah, you're another prophet. So Jesus dives deeper, which he always did, and he asked the disciples, who do you all say that I am? And then as we know Peter's personality, Peter takes the lead and takes the role and steps up and says, Jesus, the long-awaited Messiah, God, the Son of the Incarnate. And then Jesus approves, because he'd rightly identified via the Holy Spirit, that Jesus is the Son of God. But then Jesus said to the disciples and Peter, and I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. Two critical points here. The church is Christ's project. The church is, was, and will be plan A, because there is no plan B. Okay, it is plan A, and we need to remember that, especially as we are engaged in the church. And it's been a blessing to travel plan A with this congregation. Second point, the gates of Hades will not overcome it. There's good and bad in there, actually. It means that we're going to be under attack. Okay, the evil one is not going to be happy when good things are happening. But we know how the story ends, and Christ clearly said, hell's not going to be putting us out of business at the church. So we know the world's in a very difficult spot, a mess, I would say. We all agree there. But as Christians traveling together, we know that our Heavenly Father is not surprised, that he is on the throne, and he is in complete control of all things. Next slide. So, impacting tomorrow. What does it mean to have an impact on tomorrow? I couldn't talk about the past without really connecting it to where we're heading, and Pastor Chad is going to spend some time with that. But for me, this means having an impact that is greater than ourselves. How do we do something collectively together that outlives ourselves? And it's each of us wants to make a difference, which we do. We want to belong to something bigger than ourselves, which we do. And we're driven by eternity as our focus. My last quote is one by Eleanor Roosevelt, who just has a lot of great quotes and is an amazing woman. And she says, life is like a parachute jump. You've got to get it right the first time. Okay? A lot of truth to that. But it doesn't mean that we don't get second chances or third chances or fourth chances or fifth chances, because we do. What it means is that we need to be intentional about what we want out of life. For me, it's like, what's my why? What is the why? Why do I do this? Why do I not? So what legacy do we want to leave so that we can impact tomorrow? Now, Pastor Chad's going to share with us about the present and the future. But if I was able to go back and tell younger Mark, and those of you that are in your 20s or 30s, it would be to participate, take responsibility. The baton is there for you to grab. Start to take that baton. And that your history that you need to learn with this fellow group of believers is going to be critical. Take advantage of the saints of God. Take advantage. There's wisdom there. Take advantage to get to know them. Spend time with them. And again, I'll end with, do not journey alone. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. It's so good to hear your voice again here. It's awesome. At this time, we're going to take an offering. So this offering is going to be a love offering. It's to enhance our sign. Family of Flint First, we're going to ask that you still continue to give your regular tithes as we normally do in the back. This is a special love offering that is going to be dedicated, again, towards it, doing some necessary service that we need to our sign. So if you go ahead and just pray with me. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, what a joy, as we sung about, what a joy it is to be in your house today. Oh, it's so beautiful. All of us gathered together here to worship you, because you alone are worthy. Lord, help us to remember. Help us to remember all the times that you have been faithful and faithful in our own lives. Lord, as we look back and remember, Lord, we're just filled with gratitude, absolute gratitude. Lord, we're so incredibly thankful for the blessings that you pour upon on your children. You love us. And you come to us. You come to us when we were running so far from you, Lord. And my heart is so full already, as Mark indicated. We've done church. And yet, Lord, please take this offering. Multiply it. Don't just add it. multiply it, Lord, so that we can continue to do the work that you have called us to do. Lord, you don't need us. As Mark said, Lord, hell is not going to overcome the church. You do not need us, but you welcome us to come alongside of you to work where you are already working. So, Lord, continue to show us. May our eyes be open. May our hands be open, Lord, to give as you have given us. Again, Lord, take this offering and multiply it and just help us to use it where it needs to be used. And it's in the strong and precious name that we pray. Amen.
Some of us. Good to see so many out here. Okay, those of you who know Reverend Micah know that he was very elegant with his words, and there are so many words. So this is a condensed version of his letter. Greetings from Reverend Micah and Karen Rogers. Let me share with you all that while we are unable to be there personally, we are there in spirit, for far too many reasons to enumerate, yet for a few. Kira and I started attending there when we were dating, and I was making long trips from Kentucky to Michigan. Our first time at the church was a Wednesday night because we wanted to see how this church was about welcoming and introducing themselves to new people. We were instantly drawn in, and some lady named Ida May came up to us saying, "I don't think I know you. My name is Ida May. Have you been here before?" We shared we had not, and then she had the tenacity to get us in line for food, then introduce us to many people.
after it became our home church, we got married there, a cherished memory, a hallmark date, and also for our ministry that would keep going there. We were in ministry here, there at our home church as part of the tremendous staff. Pastor Scotty welcomed us immediately that first Wednesday night, invested in us, and following our wedding, took us on staff at the church. We were made family there at our home church. We were sent forth from there, our home church. We have been an incredible ministry of connection pastors, lead pastors in two different churches, evangelism and outreach. We are now resettled in Warren, Ohio, in a church that is in ongoing revival, vision realization, and mission field focus. And you all played a part in embedding that into our very beings because you became our home church. We are still calling you our home church in the Wesleyan Church. We are pastoring a Nazarene church, but you are still our home church. Yeah. Let me encourage you all in these ways. Never, ever quit welcoming everyone who is new. New people need people. Become, and never quit being a people of prayer. Finally, be people that live on the edge of expectancy. Expect God to move in your personal lives, in your services, and in your congregation. In conclusion, Isaiah 43:18-19. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a new way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Be blessed, co-laborers in Christ, and still connected to our home church. Micah and Karen Rogers. Thank you.
Good morning, Flint First Wesleyan Church family. This is Roger Parsons, and Sue and I want to take this opportunity to celebrate with you 110 years of ministry. By the way, as they would say here in the South, y'all look good for 110. What a blessing to reflect back over the years and to think about the souls that have been saved, the believers that have been sanctified, the lives that have been changed, the ministry that has taken place, your great fellowship and connection you made with not only each other, but with your community. And we celebrate that with you today. And we pray that your best years are yet to come, that you'll begin to experience a new life and new outreach like never before. So we just want to take this moment to reflect with you just for a little bit. We remember that we were in evangelistic work. Our son was on staff there, Tony and Jalen. They had no children at the time, I don't believe. I think all three of our grandchildren, three of our four grandchildren, Tony and Jalen's three children were born in that area. And we came and we needed to take a year off the road, but after 1 year, you gave us our first and last unanimous recall vote, and what a blessing. It was hard to say no, and for five more years, we were your pastor and enjoyed serving there. Pastor Donnie was on staff, a lot of great memories. One memory in particular, I was thinking about this just the other day, that when we first were coming, Chad Amos said to my wife, "Is there anything you could do for we could do for you?" And she said, "Yes, I'd like to have a new Avalanche." And when we pulled up in the driveway at Thistlewood, Chad gave my wife a brand new red Avalanche. And Chad, we've still got it. And appreciate those kinds of memories so very much. Well, while we were there, we had the five purposes. We had a new logo designed in the shape of a cross. Del Green said it looked like a swastika, but He was joking, of course. We reached out through evangelism and through discipleship, through fellowship, through worship, and through ministry. One of the things that was such a blessing is that the ministry that we were trying to be involved in at the time was 50% to the church and 50% to the community. And we had mountains of water that we gave away at events like the fair. We did lawn mowing in the neighborhood. And remember the egg hunts that we had? Gave away TVs and bikes and tried to reach a lot of people for the Lord. I just can't tell you how my heart is full of wonderful memories of our time there together. One Wednesday night, it was around Christmas time, and I was talking about the nativity and what an important role that John the Baptist played in the first nativity scene. And I made the statement that every nativity deserves to have a little John. And some of you didn't let me forget it. In fact, one person who will remain anonymous gave me a little toilet to put in the nativity scene so it could have a little John. I remember the prayer walks that I used to have with Pastor Chad over at the Baptist Church around the corner. Ultimately, that led to not only weekly times of prayer and fellowship, but also it led to outreach together. And we went door to door, knocking on doors there in the community, telling them that we were available. And what a blessing that was. So Sue and I just want to say today that we're sorry we can't be with you. We are presently serving in Fayetteville, North Carolina, home of Fort Bragg, or more recently named Fort Liberty, home of the 101st Airborne and also Faith Wesleyan Church. And after 5 years of retirement from pastoral ministry, God called us last spring to this wonderful church. And because we're so many miles away, we can't be with you today. But eat a piece of cake for me. And when you think of us from time to time, pray for us. And one of these days, we're going to get together for the great homecoming together in the sky with the Lord. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Until then, remain faithful and fruitful for Him. He's worthy of it all. God bless you and thank you.
As we go ahead and continue our service, we are going to go to our next worship song. So if you guys would like to stand up, we are going to continue to worship our Lord. Your grace abounds indeed.
may be seated. This time we're going to transition to our choir song, Press On. So if you were in the choir or you feel inclined to sing with us, we'd invite you to come forward and sing this song with us. We do have books on the front pew for people to follow along on page 40.
Did you say something?
As Christians, we're told that when we go through difficult times, that is when God comes by and he uses those times to mold and shape us into the people we need to be. And similarly, that is what happens to our church too, that when we go through difficult times, he's shaping us into what we need to be. As we think back on church history a little bit, think back to 9/11 and how we didn't even think that we could be attacked on our homeland here in America, but we were. And I've heard stories that several churches in the few weeks and months after 9/11, that they were just filled with people, many people getting saved, many people getting a right relationship with the Lord after that. And then when we fast forward about 20 years, we have come to COVID. And at that time, our government shut down schools and businesses and even churches. And many of us wondered, would we ever be back in church like we are right now? Or would we be worshiping in the parking lots or online or on TV? But here we are. We are where God wants us to be in his timing. And as we look at Philippians 3:13-14, Paul says, "But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Jesus Christ." And so, therefore, folks, we need to keep our eyes on the Lord and keep pressing on.
this on? Can you believe they trusted two old people like us with a video camera? Hey, this is Dale and Marilyn Freed. Happy anniversary, friends, at First Wesleyan Church. It's been 27 years since our young family arrived as a pastoral family at your church. I was at that time the youngest pastor in the history of Flint First. And sometimes I think I probably was too young. I was so wet behind the ears. But we had the blessing of 5 years spent there that was just truly blessed of God. I think of the wonderful staff we had the privilege to work with. Bill and Diane Christ stayed on when we came and spent those years with us. And then when they left, Phil and Amy Count came on staff. In the midst of that, we hired Angel Hobbs, her last name's Dickerson's now. Angel fell in love with a guy in Indiana and ditched us. Anyway, we hired Marilyn to be, this Marilyn right here, to be our education director, one of the best things that ever happened. She did an amazing job. I had the privilege of having godly heroes in my life that I had the unbelievable privilege of hearing them call me pastor. People like Jack and Mae Carlson, Bud and Ann Green, Art and Eva Rouse, Bob and Enid Reed, Virgil and Juanita Appleton, and on we could go. Things you want to say?
Sure. I remember events that were just so significant to us. Was one of them was Head of House Night, when the people of the congregation were invited into our home to spend an evening of fellowship. It was always so much fun to get to know people and to learn what kind of ice cream that they liked best. I also remember just all the musicals and the unity that brought to the church, the different ministry opportunities that we had there. That was terrific growing together. I appreciated the volunteers in the children's ministry during my years as education director. Carol Richardson taking on MOPS and making that such a meaningful outreach to ladies. In fact, on Monday evenings now, I volunteer as a mom coordinator or a mom mentor for our local MOPS. And it's so precious to see the ministry they have there. Five children's churches we ran at one point, and that was just so effective. It gave so many people an introduction to ministry in the church and finding that they could lead children to Jesus and teach them his ways. So it was wonderful. We loved it.
Well, Marilyn and I treasure the lasting relationships we've enjoyed through the years from our time there at Flint First. And we are praying for a blessed anniversary Sunday for you. But don't spend too much time looking back, because God is on the move for your future. God bless you. Good to see you. Take care.
Happy anniversary.
Now we've got to figure out how to shut this off. Is this on? Can you?
Well, good morning again. As mentioned earlier in the video, this is not only the first time in our storied history that our church has ever had a female lead pastor, but it's also the first time that there has been bivocational lead pastors. So if you're not familiar, bivocational is just a term that means that Amy and I are still working our regular jobs. So just to give you a little bit more about us, Amy, for example, is a registered nurse. So she does behavioral health assessments, and she does home health care. And I'm an engineer, so I work in the automotive industry. So these are jobs that we had before we became lead pastors of the church, and we've continued on in these positions and these jobs since we've started in this role. We also have three children, Nathan, Cora, and Madeline. Our son Nathan was our guitarist this morning, playing with us. He's a junior at Madonna University, dual majoring in sports management and graphic design. He also plays on the lacrosse team at Madonna University. Plus, on September 30th, he just became engaged to Allie. Allie was also on the praise team this morning. You can see them sitting up there. So let me congratulate them, yes. Cora, my oldest daughter, you see standing in the middle here, was on our praise team. She's our worship director for the church. She helps lead and organize the praise team and our practices and schedules the services. She works really hard to make sure that, you know, we coordinate our messages with the music that we sing on Sunday mornings. So she shares that responsibility. She also helps as an assistant keyboardist. So in the times when Miss Bonnie is not able to play with us, then Cora will play keyboard with us. And of course, she sings with us as well. She is also a dual enrolled student currently at Clear University. She's a senior in high school, and so when she graduates this spring, she will graduate with an associate's degree in business at the same time she gets her high school diploma. She's very active in sports. She plays volleyball, basketball, and soccer. Madeline, our youngest daughter, who was also on the praise team, you can see there standing between Cora and Amy. She's a freshman in high school. She just dual enrolled as well for her first classes at Clear University this fall. And when she not only serves on the praise team, she also serves as a barista in our coffee corner. She greets people as they come in, and she knows most people's favorite coffee. She'll know what to make them as soon as they come in. And I remember Pastor Frank used to always just walk in, and she would always know what coffee to make him, and he always thought that was super special. Madeline also enjoys playing basketball as well, so we're just getting ready to gear up basketball season, so the first practices are starting this next week, and so we're getting ready to be in a busy season with two kids on different teams going to different games and whatnot, so it's going to be a fun time, but hopefully that allows you to get to know us better for those that don't already know us. And I was asked to talk specifically at this time about the present, but I think it's important for us to understand if we're going to look at the present, we have to kind of see where we came from, to have perspective on the present. So if you look at this graph here on the next slide, I wanted to put this together because we want to understand what is going on in Flint over the last several years. And so this is 150 plus years of the population in Flint. And you can kind of see 1913, the Wesleyan Dove there. That's when Flint first started as a Pilgrim Holiness Church on Benedict Olive, when we talked about in the history. And you can see when the first GM factory opened up in 1947, and you can see what the population was doing in that time. There was a big population boom through all of that. But then there's a transition. 1963, I'll highlight that as well. That was our first service. You remember in the videos, this was our first service in this building. Was in 1963, right in the middle of that booming time frame. But in 1999, Buick City closed in Flint. And as many of you know, several other plants over the years began closing in the Flint, including, you know, the Delphi plants when Delphi became a separate company in 1999. Flint's population during that rise peaked around 190,000 people, and GM employed around 80,000 in Flint alone. So, a fun fact, before the mega churches of today, Flint First was actually listed in the top 25 churches for weekly average congregational attendance. So, I don't know if you knew that or not, but that was a pretty exciting time for the church, again, during this booming part of our history. But in the mid-80s, General Motors laid off 30,000 automotive employees. Eventually, they laid off nearly 80,000 in all between GM and Delphi combined. And of course, as I already mentioned, they shut down several factories. So as you can see on the chart, that's when the population declined. Currently, MLive says GM employs just over 8,000 employees in Flint. It's actually not Flint. It's Flint and Genesee County combined. So that's a staggering contrast to the peak population. Flint's average attendance now is around mid-70s and is considered a small church in the region. Now, I'm not sharing this to depress anyone, but I want to point out that through all of that, God has been faithful. God has been with us every step of the way. He continues to work. He continues to minister to us through us. So as we embrace the present, I want to highlight what's been going on at Flint First in 2023. And I'm happy to say that although this has been a year of transition, as we transition from our full-time pastor to an interim pastor to Amy and I as co-lead pastors, our church was not on pause during this time. We've continued to reach out into our community in various ways, and we've grown our relationship with Potter School, and we're frequently invited to help out and to their larger activities, and especially their holiday activities when they invite the parents and the families to come in to celebrate with them. We've also been asked to help develop a mentorship program with Potter Schools, and we're continuing to work out the details of exactly how we can roll that out effectively so that it can minister to the students at Potter Schools. We're also excited to see what else God has planned for this relationship with Potter School, and we can continue to invest into the children and the students. You know, when we canvass the neighborhood and we ask, what can we do to serve you in Flint, the number one response was something for the children. And so that's why we want to focus on working with Potter Schools. We want to be able to have that ministry and that doorway open, a two-way communication where we can be available to help them. Another outreach at Flint First is our food pantry. Our pantry continues to distribute food on the second Saturday of each month. This is a great outreach, and it certainly meets the need in our community. Just a couple years ago, through Nathan's Trail Life USA Freedom Award project, this ministry received a much-needed facelift. New paint, new carpet, new shelves were built. They increased the storage capacity by over 42% from the old plastic shelves that we used to have. He also raised enough money, and with ABC Warehouse's help selling us the freezer at cost, we were able to purchase a larger new freezer, which increased our freezer space by over 14%. This means we have more food that we can house so we can give out to our community. We have a regular team of faithful volunteers that serve weekly at the food bank, Wednesdays and Thursdays from 9 to 12. They put in their time. And that benefits the food bank as well as benefits us because they, for their time, get a credit that comes back to Flint First that we're able to use to then replenish our supply. With the help of God, Heather Jones and Hannah Krupp have grown a thriving MOPS ministry here again at Flint First. We've recently wrapped up our summer of ministry opportunities and to serve and to reach our community for Christ. In addition, Cora is in the process of working on her Stars and Stripes, which is going to take the youth area downstairs and give that another facelift for the church going forward. All in all, we've had some exciting stuff in 2023. We have had 9 people that have committed to Flint First by becoming new members in our community, and 5 others have expressed interest in the membership. 4 of them just recently attended a class last Sunday. We currently have 12 staff members, 10 of which are volunteers, and they're committed to serve the kingdom of God, and not just in their ministry, but in the ministries of others as well. An example of that is the trunk or treat we just had yesterday with over 700 people that came out to visit our church. You know, that is a great opportunity. Our co-missions directors, Alex and Adriana, helped spearhead that, and I just appreciate the church for getting behind them and helping to support them. We have 14 different small groups that meet regularly on different days of the week. We have over 50, well, about exactly 50. I think Marcy and I just verified that. We have 50 people that are on our prayer chain that actively support others in prayer. Our church attendance, even with the transition, has been stable. And that's exciting. Sometimes during pastoral transitions, you don't know what's going to happen. And some people get nervous, and they go somewhere else where they feel like it's, again, a more stable opportunity. But our church has been faithful, and our attendance has remained strong. Wednesday night attendance has also remained strong, with about 70% of our regular church attendance attending also on Wednesday night. So it's, again, a very strong thing to say. And as I mentioned, you know, our monthly food distribution with our local pantry. But most importantly, we've had 8 people from Flint First be baptized. 4 people have either committed to their first-time decisions or recommitted their lives to Jesus. Amen. But even with all the great things that are happening at Flint First, I would be remiss if I didn't take a few moments and recognize that some of our church family were called home to be with Jesus this year. Carol Richardson, Pastor Frank Beck, and Lina Brown, two of which were volunteer staff members and pillars in the life of Flint First. Carol Richardson went on to her heavenly home in February of this year. She wore many hats here at Flint First. Not only was she the administrative assistant, she was also the congregational care director. She was our wedding coordinator. She served on the LBA and several other committees at the church. Pastor Frank went home to be with Jesus in July. Not only did he serve as our discipleship pastor and on our visitation team, but he was active as a teacher, mentor, and comforter to so many people. He formally retired from formal pastoral ministry 18 years ago. But let me tell you, he never retired from serving Jesus. He never tired from discipling others. Both left big vacancies here, but God is still good. God is raising up leaders to help fill those shoes, to minister, and continue to do the work that needs to be done here in Flint. So continue to pray for our staff, continue to pray for our leaders as we continue to hear from God. All of us are challenged to fight the good fight, to take hold of the eternal life to which we were called when we were made our good confessions of faith. So let's do it, right? Let's do it, church. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Join me as we pray this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for your guiding us, for directing us in your will and in your ways. We not only celebrate what you've done here at Flint First, but we celebrate what you're currently doing. And we want to praise you for what we believe you will do here at Flint First as well. We know that you love this church. Lord, I'm not talking about the building. I'm talking about the people. You love us. You love us so much. We thank you for that. Oh, God, this thank you seems inadequate when you put in perspective of what you've done, Lord. But know that with our thanksgiving, we give you our gratitude, our praise, and our worship. Lord, we give our lives in service to you. Not just as our Savior, Lord, but also as the Lord of our lives. Help us to run the race that you've marked out for us, God. Help us not only to lose sight of Jesus, not to lose sight of Jesus. In the glorious and strong name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So now I have the distinct pleasure of introducing to you via video a regional superintendent of the Great Lakes region of the Wesleyan Church, affectionately known as the Chief Towel Carrier because he really does want to serve churches in his region. So Reverend Dr. Chris Conrad recorded this video for us to share some of his thoughts about our anniversary.
Hey, Flint First. I just wanted to come alongside of you and celebrate with you this wonderful, monumental occasion of your 110th anniversary. I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of the fact that your church historically has raised up leaders who have made a significant difference in the life of churches, not just right there in Flint, but around the entire country, indeed around the world. God has allowed you to ministry as a result of your church. And I just want to say, I believe that what God has done in the past, he wants to continue to do in the future, but in fresh ways, in new ways. I'm so thankful for Pastor Chad and Amy's leadership and the way that God is already using them to help build up, develop, equip, and then send out leaders. And I just want to encourage you to join with me in praying that what God has done in the past, He will do in the future. He will do fresh things in your midst. He will do new things in your midst. That some of you right now listening to this are going to be the future leaders of God's church there in Flint, and then in the area around Flint, and then in the broader world, the landscape of Christianity around the world. So here's the thing. What I would say is, Flint first, you're just getting started. You're still, if you will, in your teenage years. You've got so much more that God is going to do through you, and I can't wait to see all that God is going to perform through you as you continue to lean into Him, as you continue to develop an intimate relationship with Him, and then allow Him to work in you and through you to bless the world around you. Happy 110th anniversary, Flint First. Super proud of you, super excited about the days ahead.
I love you too, Doc.
Once there was a holy place, evidence of God's embrace. I can almost see mercy's face pressed against the veil. Looking down with longing eyes, mercy must have realized that once His blood was sacrificed, freedom would prevail. And as the sky grew dark and the earth began to shake, with justice no longer in the way, mercy came running like a prisoner set free, past all my failures to the point of my knee, when the sin that I carried was all I could see. And when I could not reach mercy, mercy came running to me. Once there was a broken heart, way too human from the start. All the years left it torn apart, hopeless and afraid.
Walls I never meant to build left this prisoner unfulfilled. Freedom called, but even still, it seems so far away.
I was bound by the chains from the wages of my sin,
and just when I felt like giving in,
mercy came running like a prisoner set free, past all my failures to the point of my knees, when the sin that I carried was all I could see.
When I could not reach mercy,
mercy came running to me. Sometimes I still feel so far, so far from where I really should be. He gently calls to my heart
just to remind me,
mercy came running like a prisoner set free, past all my failures to the point of my knee, when the sin that I carried was all I could see.
And when I could not reach mercy,
mercy came running like a prisoner set free,
Past all my failures, to the point of my knee, when the sin that I carried was all I could see. When I could not reach mercy, mercy came running to me.
One final word from a previous pastor, Reverend Jay Deneff, who was with us from 1977 to 1988. And he gave us a short note, but powerful. He said, this message from our beloved 93-year-old retired pastor, Reverend Jay Deneff, was sent by way of his daughter, Marcia Deneff. Greetings from Pastor Deneff to Flint First. He is very happy on our 110th anniversary and sends us congratulations. He said to read the scripture, 1 Corinthians 16:13, and it would tell his entire thoughts for us. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous and be strong. Amen. So much that's Pastor Deneff. We are going to take a moment and pray for our leaders. And so I would ask Pastor Chad, Pastor Amy, maybe we could gather up here. And I'm going to also say for our local board of administration, our board of trustees, directors, and other leaders in the church, I'd like you to come forward and we're going to offer a prayer for you. So praying for... Well, prayer is critical, as we talked about a little bit earlier, I did, and there's nothing more important than communicating with our Father, but we are told to pray for our leaders, and that's what we're going to do. When we pray, I'd ask you if you could stand, and if it gets a little long, please feel free to sit, it's okay, but I'm going to also ask you if you would, and it might be a little uncomfortable, it might not be, just reach out your hand in agreement as I pray, if you would. You know, just kind of you're in agreement as we're praying for our leaders here in one accord. So we have, we all here? A couple are downstairs. Do we want to, they're probably working, right? Yeah, we're not going to leave children unattended or anything like that. So they will be included in our prayer for certain. All right, let's go to our Heavenly Father. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude for the strength and leadership of our pastors and our leaders. We thank you for each and every one of them. We do recognize the challenges that they face, the burdens they carry, and the tireless efforts that they put in to shepherd the flock of Flint First Wesleyan. Lord, we pray for an abundant outpouring of strength upon our pastors and leaders. Strengthen them physically, emotionally, spiritually. When they feel weary, be their source of renewal. When they enter obstacles, be their guiding light. Grant our pastors wisdom to navigate the complexities of their role. May they lead with integrity, compassion, and unwavering faith. From Numbers, Father, chapter 6, 24 to 26, you say, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. We pray this for Pastor Chad, Pastor Amy, and all of our leaders. Bless them in a mighty way, Father. Keep your face shining and protecting them. Provide them peace that could only come from you. From Joshua 1:9, you say, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Heavenly Father, I pray for our leaders to be completely sold out servants, Father, for you. I ask for them to stand strong as they faithfully share the word of God in our in community and sharing with others around as leaders, Father. I ask for a special anointing of the Holy Spirit on them, Father, as they proclaim the truth and help them to not grow weary. Provide them protection in all areas of their lives. Place a hedge of protection around them at all times. Father, now I pray for the pastors and leaders ears to see clearly your direction for Flint First, Father. From Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, we read, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight." Give the leadership of Flint First your vision for the church, Father. It is your church, your instrument, your tool, Lord. Show them the way. Make the complex simple for them. Give them boldness to accomplish your plans for the church. Help them to minister to the community and win souls for the kingdom, Father, to disciple and send forth individuals to fulfill the Great Commission. Dear Abba, Father, I pray for love and unity for your body of believers here at Flint First. Based on John 13, 34 to 35, a new command I give to you, love one another as I've loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Father, I pray for the fruits of the Spirit for the life of this church. Give them love, peace, joy, patience, and guide them. I pray that kindness and goodness are companions, that faithfulness will be a motto of Flint First. Help them to love you, love each other, and love the ones they're called to serve. I ask these things in the matchless and precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen. What a great time to remember what God has done at Flint First over the last 110 years. We celebrate how he is still working, and we're excited as we anticipate what God's going to do in the future for Flint First and through Flint First. Thank you to the many people that invested countless hours preparing for today, many of whom were, of course, behind the scenes. Many of them, of course, prefer it that way. But there were several people on the team, including Nettie Rosser. If you could come up here, Nettie. Nettie spearheaded the planning, the organization, and leading the team in preparing for today. So please help me thank Nettie and her entire team. So thank you again to our friends of Flint First that traveled many hours and miles to be here to celebrate with us this morning. As we prepare to exit, I do have some instructions for you, and the ushers are going to come and dismiss each of the rows. So if you could, please remain seated until the ushers dismiss your row. As you exit and line up for food, we're going to go out the doors to this side, and we're going to go down the hallway. And if you haven't already, I encourage you to look at the different pictures that we have hanging up to display, to share in the history of Flint First. So right now I'm going to pray for a blessing on our food, so we won't have to wait and pray in there. So as soon as we get in there, you'll be able to get in line, grab some food, and start eating. Heavenly Father, what a blessing this morning has been. Our goal was to celebrate what you did, Lord, what you have done, and what you're going to continue to do in the future of this church. We pray, Lord, that as we continue to seek you, that you will guide us, that you will direct us into the future that you desire for us. Lord, we also ask for your blessing on the food that's been prepared and the hands that prepared it. Take this food, Lord. Use it to nourish our bodies. Help us to be better servants. Help us to better serve you. Bless our fellowship together as we eat this afternoon. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.